Autoline Live from Woodward Avenue is brought to you by our signature sponsor, Chrysler, imported from Detroit.
Welcome to this live webcast from the Woodward Dream Cruise, sponsored by Chrysler and, of course, all done by Autoline. We're here at Chrysler's display at 13 in Woodward, just outside of Detroit, and they've got a variety of new and vintage cars and trucks here and Jeeps. And in fact, every single one of the Chrysler LLC brands has got some sort of display going on here. We've got some great guests coming up, including Saad Chehab, the CEO of the Chrysler brand, Pietro Gorlier, CEO of the Mopar brand. We've even got Ralph Gilles, the head of design for the whole company, and of course, the CEO of the SRT brand. We're also going to be talking with Ian Callum, the head of all design for Jaguar. Normally, you'd expect them to be at Pebble Beach. Instead, they brought the F-Type, a couple of them, in fact, to the Woodward Dream Cruise. Those are just some of the headliners we've got in the show. We've got even more people coming up, and we'll be getting to all of that right after this.
To perfect every detail, work with a perfectionist who sweats every detail. If you want to refine a luxury car you're proud to put your name on, work with a guy whose name is his reputation. The 300C John Varvatos Limited Edition. Great things are worth the wait. Limited run of 2,000 in dealerships now. Each time you round a new corner, it's a chance to stand out. To say you're moving up. To feel good about what you've worked so hard to get. We started with a powerful car. One that's also efficient. Then added attitude and style. You see, you become the most innovative sedan in your class by never taking your foot off the gas.
As I told you right now, we've got Saad Chehab, the head of the Chrysler brand, and Pietro Gorlier, the head of Mopar. Great having the both of you here.
Well, thank you.
Saad, why don't we start with you, and then we'll get to talking with Pietro as well. But what's it mean for the Chrysler brand to be at the Woodward Dream Cruise?
Oh my God, this is like pilgrimage to us. it's a yearly thing that we must have. And we must do not only be for the symbolic part of it, but also it gives us sort of a steroid that lasts us till next August, hopefully, when we go back to work on Monday. So it's a great thing that we need to continue to do. And we obviously, as a pillar of this city, the Chrysler brand is got a duty to be here, as a matter of fact, not only just a marketing stunt.
And this is perfect for Mopar, isn't it, Pietro?
Obviously, I mean, that's the perfect place for Mopar. First of all, we can meet our core customers, the enthusiasts, and you know how important it is for us, I mean, to meet them, to exchange ideas, to gather feedback. And secondly, we celebrate cars and customization. And you know how important it is for Mopar customization. We really made customization the center of our strategy. So. So 1 million, 1 million people are expecting.
I know, a million people is a great way to get your message out, isn't it? Saad, you've got this gleaming white 200S here. What's so special about it? Why did you bring this car out?
This is what's all about imported from Detroit. This car is made in Detroit, not too far from here in Sterling Heights, Michigan. It's also customized. Only 1,300 of these cars will be built. It's a unique partnership that we have with Carhartt and the Mopar folks to help us build a Detroit version, a real Detroit version of the 200. So this car is customized with tasteful touches and uniqueness from black wheels, black grille, unique black back fascia and front fascia, and unique interiors with the Carhartt folks, with the clothing folks that there are from Detroit as well. So having this car to be built in a unique and a special way, and only in limited numbers of 1,300 this year, makes it very, very unique and special for us as well to tout in an area like this, in a day like this, especially with the way that that Pietro's team is building this car. You can tell them about,
because I got a question about it.
Yeah, tell us.
Because that's, you know, very rugged kind of clothing, really for outdoors people.
Yeah.
I would have expected Ram to do something with Carhartt. Why is Chrysler?
Well, we are about the working man's rewards. Not only, we're not a luxury brand, we're a brand that has an American personality and imposition of American cars. We don't just make cars that are boxes on wheels, we make cars with personalities, and they are a symbol of Detroit, especially the car that's made in Detroit at the same time. So we are building a true reward version of a working man's luxury car, if you want, and no better place or team to build this together with Carhartt folks.
Cool. So Pietro, I didn't mean to cut you off, but I had that question.
Absolutely.
So what's your involvement with this?
And by the way, let's talk for a moment about Carhartt. I mean, they are famous for durable, long-lasting products. And that's exactly one of the principles of Mopar. I mean, having something that is durable, long-lasting, reliable, etc. So I think there is also a connection with the Mopar brand. But what we did, you know that every year we do a special edition of our vehicles. This year was the Mopar 13 Dart that is just hitting the showrooms, great car. But we started with this car actually 3 years ago at the Detroit Auto Show. If you remember, there was a concept car we took there, and it got us such a big success in terms of the feedback from the customers. So then we went in production, so 1,300 units, different front chin spoiler, ground effect, lowered the car, rear diffuser, a great sound of the exhaust that is particular of this car, and it's really a testament for those customers that they want to have something unique. I mean, you get a limited edition car, there is a different grille, so that is really a sign of showing your personality, the fact that you want to drive a different ride. And obviously, the interior made by Carhartt, unique, rough, but durable and long-lasting.
At the same time, attainable. That's the very important part of it. We make cars that are attainable to folks, that you don't have to cross oceans and buy them twice as much as they're worth. It's $229 a month for a car like this that's loaded with all these great things that these guys have built, and also customizably built by folks from Detroit as well. So that means behind this car is a lot more meaning than just the surface of it. So we're very proud of it, and I think it's cool looking, don't you think?
I do. I agree. I especially like the grill on this thing. It really stands out.
Yeah.
But you were talking about the engine noise. Let's get somebody inside there and
start it
up. Come on, let's walk around.
Back. Can you start it? Oh, sure. Listen to the exhaust note. It's amazing. Listen to this. That's Detroit muscle for you right there.
I was going to say, it doesn't sound like no 200 I ever heard before.
It's incredible. It's almost 300 horsepower, this car.
No,
so it's a really performer car.
That's awesome. So, Pietro, you've really tricked it out under the hood here, too. Let's move over to the side so the camera can get in and show everybody.
And that, obviously, I mean, one of our signature products, the strut tower brace, I mean, giving better handling, more rigid handling, more sport feeling when you drive. And our cold air intake, I mean, really something that is allowing the 3.6 engine to breathe and perform even better. Even better.
That's great. Hey, as you guys know, we've been getting questions from the audience here. Saad, I'm going to start with you. We've got the Car Guy Canada has this question from Twitter. He says, hey, we need a manual in the LXLD cars.
That's a good question. But you know what? We do have paddle shifting, and it's very much like a manual transmission. I think you should try that on the 300S that we have with the new one that we've got. It's and we put it in sport mode. It's really very precise in terms of changing the gears. It's very much similar to a manual.
It's similar, but some of us like to use a clutch, too.
Yes, I know.
Hey, we've got another question that's just come in. Sean, what's that one about?
It's from FoopDuck2 via Twitter. Have you figured out the timing chain issue on the Challengers? They seem to brake while on the highway. Mine did.
Okay, where's Tim Kiniskis for that one?
I don't know what to say. I mean, obviously, I mean, I invite them to, if they have any kind of doubt of issue, just drop me a mail. You remember, I gave my mail also in one of our interviews. Pietro.gorlier@chrysler.com. They can drop me questions, and I'm more than happy to answer.
There you go, folks. You can get it fixed by the big boy himself right here. Let's see, I'll go back to you, Saad. Fred wants to know, can you share any details on products like the Chrysler 100 or Ypsilon in North America? These are good questions. I like our audience. I want to hear what you have.
I think they have to maybe Google or drive by the new plant that we're building up in Sterling Heights. There is a great car coming. It's called the 200. And that car is set to put us yet another plateau of what we started with. I think that's something that to look forward to. And yes, we are looking at a smaller vehicle for Chrysler, but at the same time, we got to make sure that we protect our turf of what we've accomplished so far in the past 3 years and not lose hold of that. And the 200 replacement is the number one priority for us. And it's a $2 billion project that we're all working on and excited about. So look forward to that one, I would say, first.
Fantastic. That's great. That's good to know. I'm learning things on my own show here. Pietro, Dylan wants to know, is there a possibility that we'd see more performance parts for the 3.6 liter engine and more exterior parts for the Dodge Charger, like mirror LED turn signals and daytime white running lights?
Well, let's start with the second point. Definitely yes. I mean, Charger as well as Challenger are two pillars of our strategy, so we keep on putting in the market new products. So definitely I need to check that one particular. Maybe it's a good idea. Let me have a look.
Yeah.
But I mean, for sure, we will not disappoint customers for Charger. In terms of the 3.6, answer is yes, it's coming. We are still exploiting all the potential of the Hemi engine, but we understand that now there is a growing customer base looking for performance on the 3.6. But you start seeing something here, right? I mean, some going around with the cold air intake, exhaust, etc. And maybe in the near future, also some tuning programs.
Gotcha. Okay, back to you, Saad. Rudiger wants to know, what are the chances that a halo roadster like the Crossfire would be built off the proposed Maserati two-seat sports car to help Chrysler expand its brand offering?
Please send that email to Sergio Marchionne. It's a fantastic idea, but we, at the same time, we have a lot of options for us now in the group. We have a huge group now, Italian vehicles like Alfa Romeo and Maserati, as well as the Fiat vehicles. So we have a lot of options for us. We're always looking at ideas like this. Don't lose the faith yet. We have a lot to go yet with what we're trying to build for Chrysler.
Good.
And we have a lot of love for our cars of today.
Yeah. No question about it. You got to have the love for the car that you got right now. Okay, and we've got another question coming in from Twitter. What is it, Sean?
So DarkRunner22 via Twitter asks, will they ever bring back the neons?
Neons. Well, we have a car called Dart.
Yeah.
You got to check that one out. It's a fantastic car. It's an Alfa Romeo-based car. Incredible to drive, beautiful to look at. A very affordable 40 mpg vehicle. You can't go wrong with that car. I would say check that out. It's miles and miles ahead of where Neon used to be.
No question about it. There's a lot of fans for the Neon, but the Dart is, I'll say it myself, it's a much better car than the Neon was.
Oh yes.
Okay, Pietro, back to you. We got a question from Frank, who says, okay, you've got the Mopar 13 Dart here. He wants to know, can you give us any hint as to what the next model Mopar might be?
No, I can't. But I would invite people to follow us in the next auto shows. I mean, we will try to launch the Mopar 14 as soon as possible. So, and it's going to be very exciting. It's really something that is going back to the traditional Mopar. So, stay tuned.
Very
stay
interesting.
Tuned.
I can't
stay
wait
tuned.
To see what this is going to be about. Back to you, Saad. Sean from Bear, Delaware wants to know, when are the Chrysler 200 Super S accessories going to be available to the public?
Immediately. They're actually now being shipped. These vehicles are being shipped to the dealers right now. And all these options are available immediately now. So I would contact the dealer locally, and they should have either they're coming on the way or they're already there.
And I'm ready to take orders. Ready to take orders right now.
Well, Sean, would love to hear what you're saying, Pietro, because he says, would sure love to upgrade my 200S to the Super S look.
Great. I mean, definitely. You don't get exactly the same package because obviously we are going to protect the exclusivity of this limited edition. But a lot of the performance stuff will be available for customers. So
That's good to know. Let's see here, Saad, there's so many questions, I'm not sure what to get to. A lot of questions about crossovers and SUVs for Chrysler Brand. What can you tell us about that, or what you might be thinking along those lines?
I mean, this is a similar story, I would say, where we do people movers right now. Town and Country is, if not the best, is one of the best ones out there, and it's something that we have to look at replacing it. Whether with a minivan or a crossover format, we're still debating that internally. But look for a solution on both sides to hopefully be either between us and Dodge to play that role. We are in the same showroom, so we can't be on top of each other with the same vehicle. So we have to play roles that each one of us can take, Jeep and Dodge and Chrysler in the same showroom floor. So we have to keep that in mind. But at the same time, we're looking at what are the opportunities and voids in the market that we need to fill. And that's where Chrysler comes in.
Fantastic. Hey, we got another question that just came in.
Abjwak asks, are you going to make the Mopar website more customer friendly with up to date stuff?
It's a great question. Yes, we are. I'm not happy. I mean, definitely we can make improvements, above all how we allow customers to get to our parts, and we are working hard. I hope that before the end of the year we will have a significant improvement in the website. So that is a customer that is really following us.
They are. You can tell by the questions. They're passionate people following what you're both doing here. Hey, I want to thank you both. Really good having time with the two of you. And right now we're going to go to an earlier interview that I did, just a little bit earlier, with Tony Michaels. He's the guy who runs the whole Dream Cruise, and you can learn about what he had to say. Right now I've got Tony Michaels, the CEO of the Parade Company and the executive director of the Woodward Dream Cruise. And Tony, looks like you got another smash hit on your hands.
Well, I'll tell you what, the weather is great. Just one of the real jewels of this entire region. It doesn't get any better than this. It really doesn't.
You know, I've often wondered, is this thing ever going to slack off? Not this year.
Boy, it's really not. It just gets bigger, better every year. And, you know, Chevrolet along again as the presenting sponsor. Tomorrow morning we kick off with the Cruise and Shoes 5K run presented by First Merit. People running on Woodward before the cruisers come down. Pretty neat stuff.
Plus, most of Woodward has been repaved. I saw the grounds crews out mowing the lawn and trimming everything up. It looks beautiful down here.
I think the track is pretty smooth, don't you think?
Hey, look, we've got a number of questions that a number of our viewers have sent in to ask you. Dale from Pasadena, California points out that every year the Dream Cruise conflicts with the Pebble Beach Concours. He wants to know, when are you guys going to talk to each other? Because Dale in Pasadena wants to come to Detroit to see the cruise.
Oh boy, that's a toughie. This is the third Saturday every August, and it just stays in that place. We're really sorry, but it's set in stone here in the Detroit region.
I guess we're going to have to tell Dale. Brother, you're just going to have to come out here sometime.
You got it.
Okay, Willie Armitage says, why is there no national television coverage of the Woodward Dream Cruise? I mean, what a phenomenal event, a million people attending.
Well, I'll tell you what, watch the ABC World News tonight. I think you're going to see something. And stay tuned for the next year or two on what you might see.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. Bainbridge Wells says, okay, Tony, if you could cruise on the Woodward Dream Cruise, what would be your favorite car to take?
Oh, boy, there's a lot of choices, isn't there?
You got to choose one.
How about 51 Cadillac?
Oh, you got it.
Would that be great?
You got it, brother.
Would that be good?
Okay.
All right.
Tony, thanks so much for stopping by. Cool event, and man, you guys have done a bang-up job with
that. Well, thank you. The support's wonderful, and everybody enjoy this day.
We started with a powerful car. One that's also efficient. Then added attitude and style. You see, you become the most innovative sedan in your class by never taking your foot off the gas.
There's only one car company in America that's never made a single car. And while you won't find Firestone cars on any showroom floor, they're out there, running better, faster, stronger, longer. No, we don't build cars. But make no mistake, Firestone is a car company. So whatever you drive, drive a Firestone.
There's only one talk show that covers the issues and executives that drive the auto industry. Turn to Autoline This Week, every Friday at autoline.tv or on your local PBS stations across America. Autoline This Week. You can't get more inside the industry.
Each time you round a new corner, it's a chance to stand out. To say you're moving up. To feel good about what you've worked so hard to get.
We've got Mark Phelan from the Detroit Free Press with me right now. And Mark, you're a veteran of this campaign of going to the Woodward Dream Cruise. What do you make of the new one?
This is as close to perfect a day as you are ever going to find. And traffic is still flowing, but there's thousands of cars out to sea. And a lot of the events are in full swing. Downtown Ferndale, they've got all of their stuff going, a fun fair. Here at 13 and Woodward, we've got Chrysler Performance on one side, Chevy on the other. I mean, this is just a really good start to the weekend.
No kidding. I mean, look at all the people that are here. Look at all the cars that are here. And this isn't even the official Dream Cruise. That's tomorrow. And it'll even be more nuts here.
Absolutely. And honestly, anybody who has the chance should come down early in the week to enjoy it as well. But tomorrow, I don't even know what to expect. I mean, one of the things that's great is how they keep adding new and different things. I mean, I like the fact that, you know, behind us at the Chrysler stand, they've got the SRTs and the old Chryslers, but they got some Fiats as well. Down in Ferndale, they've got the original Hot Rod Lincoln. The guy who wrote the song built the car.
It's just unbeatable.
I never suspected either. There's so much to see. I mean, so many one-of-a-kind vehicles, you know, hot rods, customs, it's perfect.
Did you see down by the old train station, they're going to have a drifting competition tomorrow?
You're kidding,
yeah.
I did not.
Yeah. No, that should be really cool.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so like you say, they keep adding events to this and spreading it all out over the Detroit area.
Yep, no, it's great. And I know that all the way up to Pontiac, all of the loop around Pontiac is going to be kind of a perpetual cruise circling downtown. And they've got all kinds of things set up in the big parking lots downtown as well.
Yeah. Hey, we've been asking our viewers to send in questions via social media this week, so I got some questions for you.
Perfect.
Carter from Chicago wants to know, Mark, if you were not a journalist and you did not get test vehicles, what car would you pay money for as your daily driver?
Oh, that's a great question, Carter. I got to say, I have two dogs, first of all, so I need something that will carry stuff around. And I think I might just go for a Cadillac CTS station wagon. Uh-oh. That's an awful lot of fun and an awful lot of practicality.
A V?
A V would be good. If I made enough money, I'd buy a V.
Yeah, well, you know, we're all pretending that we have all the money.
We're not journalists, so we're pretending we're well paid.
So Kirk wants to know, in your opinion, why is the Ford Fiesta coming in fourth place in subcompact sales in the U.S.? He points out the Nissan Versa's number one. Why? Why isn't the Fiesta
well,
doing
well,
that?
First of all, the Versa's number one because Nissan went with a very low price strategy on the Versa. The Versa sedan is a very basic small car, kind of like small cars used to be. Other than that, I think a lot of it is that the Fiesta was the last one into the party. I mean, you know, Toyota and Honda, they've got decades of equity built up in very small cars. Ford's a newcomer.
Yep. And it's, you know, fourth isn't too bad, actually.
That's
you know,
true.
They're selling a lot of them. I want to say they've sold 50,000 so far.
I think they've had like 7,000 or 8,000 a month several times.
Yeah,
and that's
right.
A good month.
Right. Okay, we've got another question from James, who says, how do you address the impression of many Chrysler loyalists that Chrysler vehicles are held to a different standard than other manufacturers and are reviewed more critically and harshly than other brands?
Wow, that's a really good... I have to say, I'm not aware of that myself. I would say, you know, for what it's worth, if you think about, you know, vehicles like the Chrysler 300, there was no shortage of people fell over themselves to say how good it was. The Ram pickup was pickup of the year last year. You know, there may have been times in the past, you know, when Chrysler was seen harshly, and they've had some real droughts in new products in their history. But I think generally when they've got something good, it gets a fair shake.
I would agree with you. I would say to James, probably you're a hardcore Chrysler fanatic. And hardcore fanatics of anything don't take criticism as well.
That's very true.
I wouldn't be surprised if maybe the press is pretty even-handed, but anyone who loves Chryslers, they hear any kind of criticism, it's like, why is the media attacking it?
No, I think you're right. And I think when you see how much interest there is in the new models, I mean, the Fiat 500, we were all dying to drive, and Chrysler builds that. And now there's the new Jeep Cherokee, which I think is one of the most eagerly awaited vehicles of the year.
In fact, we got a question on that from Lars. He says, will the automotive press become obsessive on the admittedly controversial styling of the new Jeep Cherokee, or will they focus on the groundbreaking attributes it's bringing to the market?
That's a great question, and I think the answer is both. I think some people will obsess on the fact that it looks different, and I think it should. I think trying to look like the old Cherokee would be a complete mistake, and honestly, the people who still drive the old Cherokee, they're not in the market for a new $30,000 SUV anyway.
Right.
But I think there's so much technology, it's going to get a lot of attention, and we're all going to focus on, does it have the off-road ability?
Talk about a lot of attention. Look at this horn blaster thing.
And you can't...
Perfect.
And you can't play Brown Eyed Girl too often or too loud.
Hey, have you heard of this new movie coming out called Snake and Mongoose?
I have heard about it. And the guys, they were legends back in the 70s when we were kids. I have not had a chance to see it. I hear it's very good.
Yeah, in fact, it's about Don Prudhomme and Tom McEwen, who were big megastars, especially in the 1960s, and who really revolutionized the sport of drag racing, at least from a promotional standpoint. So there's this new movie out about it, and I had a chance to have the producer of the movie, Robin Broidy, come over to the Autoline Studios, and she brought a special guest with her. She brought Billy Gibbons, lead singer, guitarist extraordinaire of ZZ Top.
All right.
So, I mean, is this a great job or what when you get to hang out with Billy Gibbons? So let's go to that interview right now.
So he just keeps a Barbie sitting at his desk like that?
I guess so. But brother, we're about to become a team. The team. But what do you think about wildlife racing as a name? I mean, you're the snake, I'm the mongoose. Kind of makes sense, right?
Wildlife racing. Hell, the way you drive, I guess that does make sense.
Very funny.
And that, of course, is a clip from Snake and Mongoose, and we've got the producer, the director of this movie, Snake and Mongoose, Robin Broidy.
I'm the producer, not the director, okay, but okay.
It's good to have you here.
Wonderful to be here.
And we got a surprise guest, too. We got Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top.
Thank you there.
Billy, great to have you here as well.
Thank you, John.
But let me start with Robin. What led you to do this movie?
Well, I wanted to make a film, and my husband loves cars and has been a car nut since he's 16 years old. And when this script crossed my desk, I knew it would be something he would be willing to talk to me about for 3 years. And so then I had to read the script, and the script had to have heart and inspiration and be uplifting and funny and action-oriented all at the same time. And lo and behold, this amazing writer, Alan Paradise, a sports, an automotive writer, he had done his job. He had done a wonderful job with the script.
Now, anybody who knows drag racing is going to know Snake and Prudhomme, or Snake and Mongoose, it's going to be McEwen and Prudhomme.
Right.
But this is more than just a drag racing movie.
Absolutely. This is behind the scenes. When I showed this movie to the ESPN execs and the Source Interlink execs or any of these car people, I say, you know the story, what happened on the track. I don't need to show you over and over that. What you don't know is how driven they were, what impetus is behind them, what their families were like, who drove them behind the scenes. And that's what this movie will share with you.
And of course, that opening scene is they're just signing this huge deal with Mattel and Hot Wheels. And that was a very unique combination of how they sort of collaborated together from a promotional standpoint and then tried to kick each other's teeth in on the track.
Absolutely. What I love about those moments in the film is everybody knows there was a Hot Wheels deal, but nobody knows how they got it. Nobody knows what they said to Art Spear, the Mattel executive played by Noah Wiley in the film. And now we show it to you. So for all the entrepreneurs out there, there's a real opportunity to see, you know, these two guys wearing their bell bottoms, walking into a huge behemoth company and selling an idea.
So, Billy, we got to ask you, what's your involvement in the movie?
Well, I came to know Robin as this picture was under development, and the musical side of things started taking shape. And then once I realized the content, here is a assembly of some of the most important pivotal turning points in a racing sport that I've followed since I was 5 years old that brought two unsuspecting guys together in a very appealing and magnetic manner in the fact that they were truly rivals. It was not made up. And I think what brings a nice focus out of the film is the technological developments that these two guys, flying by the seat of their pants, were inventing on the spot. Sleeping in a van, going from place to place as things began unfolding, and then the true rivalry took over, and that's when the real wrenching started making sense.
So tell about the music that you're doing for the movie. Is this something new that you've written, or what?
Yes, is that? Robin has masterfully put all the perfect period pieces together that follow a timeline. We were fortunate enough to get I'm Bad, I'm Nationwide in.
Wow.
And of course, that pretty much sums up what these guys were all about.
Exactly, exactly. When we met Billy, we were so excited to get to know him, and we begged for the song because it was so perfect for the moments in the film that we cover. And his song underscores the incredible rise to stardom of Don Perdomo.
So tell our viewers where they can go check out anything about the movie.
So they can find it on www.snakeandmongoosemovie.com. We have a Facebook page, Snake and Mongoose. You can follow us on Instagram and Twitter at hashtag Snake and Mongoose. We want to meet all of our fans, and we want to share the movie with everyone. So that's where you can find it. And we open here in Detroit at the Uptown Palladian 12 tomorrow night. And there's a red carpet premiere open to the public. So if you just show up and buy your ticket, you'll be able to see the movie and see some celebs.
Terrific. I want to thank both of you for coming into the studio and bringing us up to speed all about the movie and your involvement in it. Thank you again.
Thank you.
John.
Thanks, John.
Appreciate that. Yep.
You know, I told you not to run those 430s, Tommy. You can see what happens when you don't hit your shift points. You know what I mean? It's like dropping a hand grenade down in the middle of the motor. You're killing parts, you know that.
Gotta push it sometimes, Ed. Roll the dice. I mean, if I want any chance of beating Don, I can't always play it safe.
Roll the dice. Okay.
Listen, baby.
Detroit is all about the sound and the drive. Dedication to our passion is what defines us. And if cars are our city's heart, music is its soul.
Oh, baby, there ain't no mountain high enough.
We are Motown, and this is what we do.
Ain't no river wide enough.
Each time you round a new corner, it's a chance to stand out. To say you're moving up, to feel good about what you've worked so hard to get.
From Shanghai to the Silicon Valley, the auto industry may make news around the globe, but there's only one spot to get your daily dose. Check out Autoline Daily at autoline.tv, Monday through Friday at noon Eastern. Autoline Daily. For the concise word on everything cars.
As we promised you all, we now got one of my favorite guests of today's show, Ralph Gilles. Ralph,
how you doing, John? Nice to see you.
Head of all Chrysler design and CEO of the SRT brand. So you're here at the Dream Cruise. Initial impressions, what do you think?
It's amazing. It's been a great week. You know, the Dream Cruise has become like a 3-4 week long thing in Detroit anymore. Weather's been perfect. People are willing to get out. It's ideal. It's probably going to be one of the best ones ever.
And you guys, Chrysler LLC, have got every single brand here.
Yeah,
you're showing a lot.
We pull out all the stops. A lot of great stuff. A few reveals even. We got some the Rumblebee that was shown today. A lot of good stuff for the fans. And I love seeing the families come by every year.
And a Ram concept truck coming tomorrow, too.
Yes. Excellent.
But you know, enough of just standing around talking. Let's get in the car.
Sure.
Let's get out on
Woodward. Let's go experience
it,
right?
Yeah,
check it out. You a convertible guy?
I'm a convertible guy, but only in the summertime.
I know.
That's the problem of living in the snow belt. You know, there's.
Yeah.
I'll tell you though, there's nothing like being on a late September, even an October evening,
mm-hmm.
out for a drive with the heater on. Sometimes even I'll go with my wife.
Oh, that's fun.
We'll have a throw or a blanket or something like that. And having the top down with the stars at night, it's just awesome.
Yeah, it is. My problem is my bald head. I just get fried whether it's cold or hot. I need some UV protection.
Yeah.
That's all good.
So is there anything that you especially look for at the Dream Cruise? Is there a favorite that you go, God, I hope I
You know what? I'm constantly inspired. I love to see how people interpret the cars. And the Dream Cruise, it's old and new, right? Everything is, it's muscle cars, ancient muscle cars or vintage cars. But no, it's brand new stuff. It's a great mix. You get import vehicles. And every single car has some form of expression of the owner. And I love that. You can almost deconstruct who owns this car. Why did they do this? What are they like? Look in who they are they, you know? So it's a great, it's kind of like anthropology on a road. Fantastic.
So is there any time that you see something like from the past you go, ooh, note to self, there's a design cue we could work with or anything like that?
All the time, and it reminds you of the staying power of great design. You know, you're in these situations, you see a car 40 years later, 50 years later, it still makes your heart beat, you know? And as a designer, you want to try to create lasting designs and iconic designs, so it's always like that for me. When I see an older Cuda, and I see the T-bucket type mod cars or the hot rods and the new trend now, which is these kind of rat rods. I love that stuff.
I love the rat rods.
They're awesome.
I really do. Those are artists. They're not even necessarily hardcore car guys.
Yep.
There are artists working on that.
And you don't have to have a lot of money. You don't have to have a crazy amount of money to have fun. And you see people give thumbs up to a lot of different stuff. And that's the ultimate cool part is the voting gal. You know, the people on the lawn chairs. And you're driving by, you're nervous. Are they going to like it or not? They almost need number cards.
There's a great idea. Yeah. I'm going to suggest that on the radio.
So, as long as they don't throw turkeys out at you.
Yeah. So... I somebody told me just yesterday that you got a hell of a group at SRT. You got true hardcore racing and car people in that group.
Absolutely. You know, they find us. You know, a lot of these young engineers, they graduate and they want to work for SRT. Now, it's not so easy, right? You got to earn your way into SRT. You got to be established as a great engineer. But most of our engineers are racers. They're ex-muscle car builders, drag racers. They're fabricators. You have to have the passion because it's hard work. It really is. It's not easy to develop as a performance car. It's actually a lot more testing, a lot more dynamics work. So we tend to hire, unfortunately, like-minded people, so we might be in a rut. But, you know, we really, truly, truly love cars. Yeah.
So you guys were at Le Mans this year with the SRT.
Yes.
Still got to find a little bit more speed. And it's a new program, right?
Yeah. And Le Mans is unique because you have a balance of performance. You have two, you know, the European contingent coming. You have the American. But the Le Mans, you know, the U.S. version, we found a lot more speed, you know, and most of it's handling. A lot of it's setup. This year at Road America, we were 6 seconds faster than last year. And it was all handling. The fourth car hasn't changed.
Six setups.
I know. Just getting to know the car.
So you're a design guy. I mean, you've got an appreciation to, you know, all kinds of different cars, right? You're not just out here looking for old Dodges or Chryslers.
You're absolutely right. I'm a big fan of anything, whatever make it is. I don't really care where it came from because as a designer, you can see through that and understand the passion. We can see through a design whether that designer won that battle, you know, whatever fight he had with engineering, if he got his way, you know what I mean?
Right.
And as certain things we can't always accomplish as designers that the public finishes for us. You know, they put the bigger wheels or the more radical paint job or whatever it may be. And that's what Woodward Dream Cruise is all about, the dream part. We have the initial dream and people put their own stamp on it. So it makes it really fun to come to an event like this and see people's personal expressions.
No, I agree. I the more they modify their cars, that's some of my favorite stuff to see. You know, like you say, where people are putting their own imprint on a vehicle.
Don't get me wrong, they go too far. I've seen some stuff that makes me dry cry, I say, you know, it's like cars that look like rolling pinatas or something.
Right. But, you know. I know. Sean, got any questions there?
Yeah, we got a few here. Willie from Connecticut would like to know, when can I get an SRT version of the Dart?
That would have to be the SRT version of the Dart would have to be the number one request I'm getting. And I can't blame him. I want one too. But, you know, I put a question out a few months ago on Twitter. I said, hey, so what kind of horsepower would you guys want to see? Nothing was less than 300 horse. Now, unfortunately, we don't have a four-cylinder pressure-charged engine that meets exactly those requirements right now. So we got to wait till it's like fine wine. You don't want to come with bad wine. You got to come with the best stuff because the expectations are really high now.
Especially with SRT.
Yes.
You can't do anything half you know what.
Exactly. You got to represent.
Another one, Sean?
Yeah, Steve from Wisconsin would like to know, when will Chrysler return to NASCAR? We need that to happen. I'm a salesman for you, and my customers are always asking that question.
The second most popular question I get. And I wish I had the answer right now. It's something that it's bigger than me at this point. I'm the enabler. I'm the one the company says, if we want to go NASCAR, but I don't make the ultimate decision. It's not my call. People flatter me with a lot of credit that I can make that call, but it's a huge question of marketing. It's a huge question of the right team. There's very few teams that, for as small as we are, we got to go with one team, right? We can't afford to have 10 cars on the grid. So, you know, again, we don't go in there unless we can do it absolutely perfectly. So it's under review. But my boss said it, and I'll say it, we never count us out. We're always full of surprises.
Got another one there, Sean?
Oh, definitely. Don from Toledo, is there going to be a Viper Roadster?
Let's put it this way. The vehicle was prepared for it. It was designed, it's a roadster underneath. The frame is absolutely designed for that. It's got a lot of rigidity. The roof is actually cosmetic on the car. It doesn't offer any extra rigidity. So let's just say when, you know, we can barely make the ones we have on order already, so there's no need for it. No rush right now. So if the public wills it on, we'll find a way. You know?
Okay, BW from California, which non-Chrysler car would be your dream car choice to drive in the Dream Cruise?
Huh, that's a very, very good question. I love the 50, like a late 50s Cadillac Biritz, like a big, ostentatious... I'd even put the horns on the front, you know, and it'd have to be pink. I love those things. They're just so ridiculous. I love them.
That's great.
If we, Mike from Illinois, I would love to see a new Roadrunner or Super B from Chrysler that is styled like the 1969 cars. Is there any chance of that?
I believe it's cool. That's a great idea, and there's a lot of, it's an easy grab, but we have to be careful we don't overmine the past. You know, so we're okay. We're obviously known for having a little heritage here and there in our naming and our colors, and the Challenger is clearly a throwback. And even the Charger has a little bit of DNA transfer, but I don't want to overuse that well because then you're disrespecting the past. So I would say no on that one, but the DNA of such an idea, why not?
You know? Hey, and we've got to wrap this up right now. We're going to go for a quick commercial break to our friends at Chrysler, but Ralph, hang around for just a minute. And
you're at one of my favorite pit stops.
Yeah.
I love this pit stop here. Take care.
To perfect every detail, work with a perfectionist who sweats every detail. If you want to refine a luxury car you're proud to put your name on, work with a guy whose name is his reputation. The 300C John Varvatos Limited Edition. Great things are worth the wait. Limited run of 2,000 in dealerships now.
Introducing a car company that's never made a single car. Legendary durability. Impressive mileage. Firestone tires. So unstrap the saddle, as these old stallions are ready to run again. Whatever you drive, drive a Firestone.
Opinion, gossip, and true believers. Plus, cars, cars, and more cars. Join us live each Thursday at 6 p.m. Eastern for Autoline After Hours on Autoline.tv. That's Autoline After Hours, where performance meets opinion.
We started with a powerful car. One that's also efficient
then added attitude and style. You see, you become the most innovative sedan in your class by never taking your foot off the gas.
Whether it's on television, online, or through social media, Autoline knows how to effectively get your marketing message to the people you want to reach. Contact Stacy Eamon today.
Listen, baby.
Detroit is all about the sound and the drive. Dedication to our passion is what defines us. And if cars are our city's heart, music is its soul.
We are Motown, and this is what we do.
Ain't no river wide enough.
Dream Cruise isn't just about old cars here. We've got a real brain trust of the design community. So Ralph was telling me, Ian, and we've got Ian Callum here, head of design for Jaguar, that you guys are Twitter buddies.
Yeah, we are. We just talk to each other occasionally. We get involved in these little conversations with people. It's quite fun, actually.
The design community has probably got to be the most tight community in the entire automotive industry. Not the powertrain guys, not the manufacturing, definitely not the purchasing. Design, you guys seem to get along better than anyone else.
We do. And a lot of mutual respect. You know, a lot of mutual respect for design. You ask me other manufacturers who's doing a great job. I love this F-Type. I think it's stunning. It's well-designed. I think Ian is well-respected in the community.
Thank you.
You know, we'll self-critical, but also self-applauding. You know, so nice
thank
job.
You thank you. Very
enjoy.
Very
Ralph, thanks so much for your time. Really good having you, man.
Good seeing you.
Yeah. So, Ian, good seeing you.
Yeah, it's great to be here.
And have you ever been to the Dream Cruise before?
No, I haven't. I always did Pebble Beach, you see. You know, formal stuff. You know, uniform and everything, ties. No, I wanted to come once. We've got the F-Type here at the moment, so I thought it'd be the right time to come and show off the F-Type and look at some of the cars I love to look at.
Why here and not at Pebble?
Well, I've done Pebble a lot of times, maybe 17 years now. I love hot rods. I mean, it's as simple as that. I love American car culture. As you know, I've got a couple of hot rods back home in England. So, you know, I just want to see, I want to soak up some of this at least once.
Any favorites that you're really hoping drive by here that?
Well, you know, I've got a 32 coupe. It's one back there, actually. I saw a minute ago. No, just anything. You know, I love cars. And I'll make my judgment on the quality of the car rather than the type of car it is, really.
So take us through the F-Type. I know our viewers have seen this. We've done a lot of reporting on it, but you brought two beautiful examples here for
us. Yeah, I feel like I've spoken about this car for 10 years now, almost. You know, it's a new sports car from Jaguar. It's all about proportion. It's all about squeezing the best proportion out of the car we can. And, you know, the modern car these days, that's very difficult to do because you've got so much stuff you have to package. And it's all about two or three simple lines of the car as well. It starts off with a very powerful front end, some beautiful simple lines, and then it runs into the tail of the car, which is actually my best favorite part.
Yeah. And what's been the reaction out here? I mean, the Dream Cruise crowd, of course, who, you know, old car nuts, but I got to believe that these cars are making people stop and look.
It's you know, I literally only got off a plane about 20 minutes ago, so people, from what I see so far, people are really loving the car, absolutely. And what was nice, I mentioned the plane because I was on the plane and this lady said to me, what are you going to do? I told her I was. And she said, wow, Jag's really coming on. I thought, at last, people are noticing. And that's what this car's all about.
That's great, you know, voice from the regular people kind of.
Absolutely.
You know, recognizing the accomplishment that Jaguar is pulling off right now.
Yeah, and what this F-Type is about is about getting Jaguar back to the center of the sports car brand again. We've lost it for such a long time. Yeah, we've got the GT and the XK, but this is a real sports car from a driving point of view.
Mm-hmm. And let's stand up by the curb so the camera can catch some of the cars going by. And
sure.
We've gotten quite a few questions from viewers of ours.
Okay. They always worry me, you know that.
we'll try to... Okay, Willie Armitage from Wilton, Connecticut says, how long until we get an F-Type coupe really sexy like the closed D-Type was?
Well, from a PR point of view, I'm not allowed to tell you.
Yeah.
But if we were to do a coupe, it won't be too far away.
Okay.
That's all I can say, really.
Don from Toledo says, great job on the F-Type, but why did you steer clear of a more traditional Jag face?
Well, because we've done the oval mouth for so long now. And, you know, I even indulged in it with the XK with a whole generation of cars, I thought it was time to move on. And if we hadn't moved on, we'd be accused of being retro. So we have to keep moving forward. And, you know, Sir William Lyons would never have got back. He always moved forward.
You've got to do that. You're absolutely right. And yet, look at the front end. I mean, it just screams Jaguar. Even if the badges were off, it
Thank
you'd know
you.
Instantly.
Thank you.
You'd know instantly.
Thank you. Yeah, it's strong, strong.
Let's see here. Dale Finchley from Pasadena, California says, the current XJ is so striking, it almost makes the the XF seem boring. Anything in the pipeline to spiff up the XF? That's sort of, you know, praise by damnation.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. No, we've got the new models in the pipeline. We're working on the new XF already. The thing about it, it's about marketplace. You see, the XF is about a more normal car. It's a bit more of a standard family car, whereas the XJ is an indulgence, and it's meant to look that way. We try to differentiate the cars quite deliberately in that way. It's also much more difficult to package as well, but I love them both.
I can believe you do. We've got another question here from Alan in Ferndale, Michigan, right here locally. He wants to know, why don't we get the XF wagon in the U.S.?
Well, you have to ask the marketing boys that one. I love the XF wagon. If we did a V8 version, I'd have one tomorrow, but we just do a V6 diesel. It's another reason. It's a pain, it's a shame, but we're just not going to bring it here, because the fact of the matter is the business case is not strong enough and the volume's not big enough. People here actually don't buy enough wagons.
They don't.
They should do, because I think it's probably one day going to be the next big thing, but when it is, we'll be there.
I'm with you. I think it'll be the next big thing. Yeah. Oh, there's some amazing things going by here as we're standing here. In fact, let's see, where was that question here? Bainbridge Wells wants to know, which non-Jaguar car would be the car of your dreams to take to the Woodward Dream Cruise?
I'd love to bring my own car here, which is a 32 coupe. I'm very proud of it. I wouldn't say I built it all myself, but I built a good bit of it myself. It was all built in England, but from American parts, of course. From the original 32 body shell, which was a bit of a mess. I'm very proud of it. I'd like to bring it here one day and drive it.
That'd be cool.
Very quick.
It would go very well.
I could be in England in the back. That may upset a few people.
That's okay. You could put a few Union Jacks on there, too.
No, I would go that far.
Samson Rolamite from Rachel, Nevada wants to know, with Land Rover part of the company, is there still a need for a Jaguar crossover or SUV for some markets?
You'll have to wait and see that one. Again, I can't talk on future products.
Yeah.
But let me tell you that in the Jaguar portfolio, we're looking at absolutely everything at the moment, from small cars to SUVs. Not to say we're going to do them all, because we can't afford to do everything. But it's going to be a very exciting. Next 5 years will be very exciting for Jaguar. Lots of new stuff coming out.
It's so exciting for me to see Jaguar really lighting up right now. I know, when the company was in transition there, maybe some things got delayed, but now looks like you guys are really coming on strong.
Well, I think this is a catalyst as well. This gets people to really understand what the brand is about. And we're on fire in a good way.
In a good way, that's right. Yeah. Ian Callum, thanks so much for taking the time today. I really appreciate
You're
it.
Welcome.
So cool to see you out here at the Dream Cruise.
I'm loving it. The noise alone is fantastic.
It's probably the first time I've interviewed anybody at the Dream Cruise with a British accent.
Oh, well. I'll bring my brother along next time.
There you go.
That's
a good deal. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Okay, folks, we're going to take a quick break now. Thank our sponsors at Chrysler, and we're coming back. We're going to go back out on Woodward and see more of the Woodward Dream Cruise.
Each time you round a new corner, it's a chance to stand out. To say you're moving up. To feel good about what you've worked so hard to get.
There's only one talk show that covers the issues and executives that drive the auto industry. Turn to Autoline this week. Every Friday at Autoline.tv or on your local PBS stations across America. Autoline This Week. You can't get more inside the industry.
Introducing a car company that's never made a single car. We took the power of a 9-year-old V8 and gave it the impressive handling of Firestone's Destination tire. Now, moms agree, every milk run feels like a victory lap. So whatever you drive, drive a Firestone.
We started with a powerful car. One that's also efficient. Then added attitude and style. You see, you become the most innovative sedan in your class by never taking your foot off the gas.
Autoline offers you one of the most effective ways to get your marketing message in front of the decision makers in the global automotive industry. Contact Stacy Eamon today.
To perfect every detail, work with a perfectionist who sweats every detail. If you want to refine a luxury car you're proud to put your name on, work with a guy whose name is his reputation. The 300C John Varvatos Limited Edition. Great things are worth the wait. Limited run of 2,000 in dealerships now.
Listen, baby.
Detroit is all about the sound and the drive. Dedication to our passion is what defines us. And if cars are our city's heart, music is its soul.
We are Motown, and this is what we do.
Ain't no river wide enough.
We're back live, and I've got Jim Hall in the car with me right now, and at the Woodward Dream Cruise again.
You know, another year, another Dream Cruise, and again, they keep getting, you know, better and better. It's incremental improvement, but it's always better, and we have great weather today.
No doubt about it. You know, I had Tony Michaels, the guy who runs this whole thing, organizes it all. And I put that to him. I said, you know, I've always wondered, when is this thing going to start dying down in popularity? It's not happening.
It dies down when cars die down in popularity. So it's, you know, sometime around probably 2039. Nah, 2209.
Yeah.
Ah. And we have to sort of pace the fabulous Dodge Ram camera truck.
That's right.
And it's like, guns cool. Okay, I'm going to ask you a question.
Yeah,
go ahead. What have you seen here you didn't expect to see today?
Oh, what have I seen? There was some monster truck that drove past us with these giant, like, fog horns on it, just blasting out music and sounded like some ship coming down Woodward.
Was that the, it was like a 650, F-650 Super Duty or something, and it was blue?
Something like that.
It was amazing. We have an interesting car up ahead. It's the Generation 2 Plymouth Barracuda, and it's a convertible, which is very rare. It looks like a 60, I want to say a 67, but I'm, my...
66?
67, no, it's 67 or 68. And it's, these are cool cars. And fortunately, they get preserved, you know?
Yeah, no doubt about it. That is really cool. There's an old Falcon, too.
Yes, and it's not like it's a Falcon V8 Futura, but it is not the really desirable one, which is the Falcon Sprint, which had a Mustang engine in it.
So is there anything that you're really hoping to see here?
Yeah, I'm hoping to see another Cord. Last Saturday at the Berkeley Coney Island, where I will have breakfast sometimes on Saturday, I was sitting there, and a Cord 812 Roadster, a two-seat, 36 Cord.
Black, a real one.
A real one. No, this was real. And it was absolutely striking. So I'm hoping the guy's going to be out this time, too, because it was actually one of the prettiest Cords I'd ever seen. It's a short wheelbase two-seat convertible. It's the second prettiest Cord they ever built.
My favorite that I've seen out here, I haven't seen it in years, though, was a World War II-era half-track with a 50-caliber machine gun on the back. And I love that thing.
Hopefully they had rubber half track or rubber tracks in the back, because I got to think the real tracks would just tear it apart. That's the Barracuda.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Beautiful car.
Okay, and it's a, I believe it's a 67. Looking at the back, I can't, you know, they all blur together. This is horrible. I you know, but they're really cool cars. And the thing is, it was in fact a Valiant that was reskinned. It had a Valiant cowl, so it's lots of Valiant sheet metal. But it still was okay, because remember, a Mustang was a Falcon.
That's right.
Now, the Mustang owners are going to hate me for saying that.
But it's true. But it's true. Hey, Sean, we got any questions for Jim?
Oh, of course. Bainbridge Wells would like to know, and it's the same question we threw out to Ralph, which would be your dream car choice to drive in the Dream Cruise?
That's a hard one.
I think there's this thing. Would I want it to be some older American Iron or something really cool now? And I think it's a two-part question. If it's older American Iron, it would be a 1970 Plymouth Barracuda, a CUDA 340, with a handling package. And if it were a contemporary car, the truth is, I've never seen a Bugatti Veyron here, and I got to think it would have people just their jaws drop, especially with one with the blue carbon fiber and the polished aluminum fenders and doors. You know, that's one where no one will miss it. But I don't like to make big things like that. So that was for the folks at home. Now, how long until this car over here, a Prius, becomes part of the Dream Cruise?
Probably when we run out of oil and there is no more on the planet, and we have levitating cars that run on crystals, then people will get nostalgic for the Prius.
It has wheels. You know, when you think about what would be a car that's out now that has the potential to be a car that would be significant here, it's really interesting, because in some cases you may be talking about things like Fiskars.
You could be. You absolutely could be. Very rare, you know, and rare is what makes collectible.
And striking to look at.
Right.
The only thing is, an over-restored Fisker in, let's just say hypothetically, 2055 probably would be over-restored if it ran.
That's pretty good.
Hey, look, it's Tom Magnum's car. Oh, no, because it's the coupe, the far more desirable coupe than the Roadster with the blocked-out quarters.
That's the 308?
Yeah, 308. And the really desirable ones are the fiberglass body ones for some reason, because they originally the car had a fiberglass body, and I don't know why, because they actually were kind of wavy. It shows why Pininfarina and Scaglietti normally didn't do fiberglass.
I like the YouTube video that's out of a Honda Odyssey drag racing a 308, and guess which one wins.
Yeah, you know, those cars really, but that's true for a lot of exotics. They're cars that we hold in tremendous reverence today, and a Ferrari Daytona, it's a quick car. But it is not as fast as its specs would make you think if it were built today.
Yeah.
A 12-cylinder car today with an engine like that would be a lot faster. Well, to wit, the Ferrari 712.
Right. No doubt about it. And, you know, it just shows how much we've advanced and really how bad cars got in the 70s and even early 80s.
Yeah, that's the thing. When I remember when you had cars like F cars, Pontiac Trans Ams and Z28s, and the Trans Ams still had big block Pontiac engines in them, but they were doing like 0 to 60 times of 10 seconds. A Camry will do that.
Yeah. Sean, you got another question there?
Oh, of course. Beauregard Jackson would like to know, Jim, you host the Design Handbook. What lessons can designers learn from looking at the classic cars on Woodward and other events?
Good question.
Woo! Well, a couple of things. One, personality counts for a lot. If you look at the cars here that people are paying attention to, they invariably have some sort of character or personality that's visual. It's the loud car that every now and then people go, oh, yeah, well, look at that, because it's making noise. But generally speaking, if you look at cars, it's something that is unlike another car. Now, that said, you've got vehicles like, I hate to say this, Roadrunners, which were basically just Plymouth Belvederes. That the difference on them were things like a Roadrunner stripe on the side or a hood scoop. But they're desirable because the personality the car has as being this affordable car. So designers, they have to figure out, one, what is personality? Because personality, from a design standpoint, evolves with design. But in some cases, it's a vehicle that has something special. So when you see it, it isn't like something exactly like something else out there. I mean, and we're going through cars here from the mid to late 70s on the right, mid to late 60s, a lot of GM cars, where they were managing how many divisions? Five brands, and they kept them all absolutely distinctive and individual. And going over there is a very rare Pontiac Grand Prix convertible, 1 year only, 1967 blue. There's another. I would like one of those. That would be a cool car for this, but in Verdoro green. I'm picky, aren't I?
What else, Sean?
All right, we got one. Timothy in Garden City, Michigan asks, I have just seen the new concept from Cadillac, the El Mirage. I think it's stunning. I would love to hear your take on the design.
Cadillacs need to be special. They have to have a sense of occasion when you look at them. They did that with that car. They actually did. It's got great stance, and that's another one where we talked about it in a recent design handbook about dash to axle, and it has a very distinctive dash to axle. It's one of those cars you look at it, and Cadillac has a larger rear drive platform they're working on, and I'm hoping that the El Mirage is in fact the design religion car for what that new model is going to be, because if it is, they'll have a car that's extremely distinctive with presence, and most importantly, it looks like what we consider Cadillacs today.
What did you make of the new grille graphic on the El Mirage?
You have to evolve your grille graphics. You can't do the same grille over and over and over and over again, which Pontiac arguably did towards the end. They kept doing the Pontiac Shield grille. They didn't reinterpret it. It was happening with Cadillac. I mean, it really was. If you look, there was this argument that the CTS and the original STS and so on were turning into one sausage, two sizes. And the ATS, they broke that a little bit with the new CTS, because the lamp graphics are now horizontal. So they aren't doing the same face sort of interpretive. You have to evolve your look. And when you do it right, that's how design actually happens, because design is not static. It's constantly changing into progression.
Got another one there? Is any good?
So we got another one here, and it says there's a ton of front engine cars here, but I'm sure there's also some rear engine ones as well. What are the pros and cons of those vehicles?
Whoa. Well, if you mean real rear engine, you know, there's only one real rear engine car in production right now, the Porsche 911. Mid-engine is different. I'm going to just quickly explain. A mid-engine car is a car where the engine is ahead of the rear axle center line, so it's much better from weight distribution. Rear engine means it's after the rear axle center line, like things like Beetles and Corvairs and Renault Dauphines and a bunch of other cars, none of which are made other than 911.
Actually, I'll correct you. I can't believe I'm correcting Jim Hall. A mid-engine car is any car with an engine in between the axle lines.
You're right, and there's front mid-engine, like the new Corvette and so on, but there's rear also, so as opposed to actually a rear engine hanging out over the back, you're right, because front mid, most sports cars are front mid.
Yes.
They actually are, and a lot of sedans are front mid.
Yep.
But the problem with a rear-engine car, if it's really the one hanging over the axle, you've got the weight in exactly the wrong place when you turn the car, because it's like a pendulum. It wants to turn, and then when it does turn, heaven help you. You better have fast steering. Mid-engined is great. You get a low polar moment of inertia, so the car wants to change directions pretty easily, which can be a problem. And if you want all-wheel drive, rear engine and mid-engine can be done, but it's kind of, there's some monkey motion going on.
Is there another one?
Oh, there is another one. I'm sure you'll be seeing plenty of Coke bottle-shaped cars today, or the lenses today on the cars. How do you compare them, and which one do you think looks best with Coke bottle lenses?
Well, it's not Coke bottle lenses, right? It's the Coke bottle shape to the body side.
Oh, yes.
Coke bottle shape, wow. You know, because the truth is, a great car is an original Jag E-Type, and you see those here.
You do, and, you know, Pontiac, mid-60s Pontiacs, really had a Coke bottle shape to them.
Yeah, and that's one, the 68-69 Pontiac A-Bodies, which was Le Mans, GTOs, and Tempests, they had a spectacular Coke bottle on them. They really did. I mean, another one that people forget about is the 1971 through 70, I believe, Ford Dodge Charger. In plan view, had a tremendous amount of Coke bottle, but the king of the Coke bottle shapes,
yeah, right.
68 Corvette.
Yeah.
I mean, to the point where the Coke bottle shape in the Corvette, and I wish there was one nearby we could see it, because it's a relatively common vehicle. They used the frame of the 67. They modified the frame of the 67 first. Ah, a Mustang. Makes noise. Hope it has a good engine in it. If they could hear me, they could be throwing things. The Coke bottle shape in the 68 Corvette was done by actually pinching the waist in, and they made the interior slightly narrower.
So do you think Coke bottle will ever come back? Corvette, yeah, of course. I'm not talking sports cars. I'm talking about sedans now.
There's a feel of Coke bottle in the new Mercedes S-Class, in that it's got this form that bulges out, and some BMWs have it, but they're doing Coke in the rear only. I don't know what that is, if that's a Coke bottle or half a Coke bottle.
Coke Light.
Coke Light, yeah. It's definitely not Coke Zero. The problem with Coke bottle shapes in plan view is that they're not good for aerodynamics.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, you can still get pretty clean cars today and still have more shape in the side.
Form is different from Coke bottle, because in Coke bottle, you're actually bringing the body in behind the wheel, so you create a low pressure zone.
Mm, gotcha.
So you're building up drag, yeah, after the rear wheel. That's why the idea of the car widening at the rear, or at the back of the front wheel, is probably better from an aero standpoint.
Yeah, right.
And that's what BMW is doing with a lot of their cars now.
Yeah, more teardrop shape.
Exactly. And they don't look, if you do that with a car, you could end up with a car that looks overbodied, because it gets so fat in the rear. If you don't widen the track, it's like the last generation rear drive Caprice before they did the cop car. Remember the Moby Dick Caprice? There was so much body past the wheel that the things looked knock-kneed when you saw them.
Another question, Sean?
One more question. You seem to know so much, Jim, that we've stumped our viewers of any other questions.
Hooray!
That's okay. The show's actually running a little bit long. I think it's probably a good time to wrap it up. But Jim Hall, thanks for joining us, man.
John, thanks.
And we want to thank all of you who have tuned in. Hope you enjoyed all the different guests that we had here. You know, it's still just a little over 5 o'clock Eastern Standard Time in Detroit. The real craziness is going to get going in another couple of hours here. If anybody's in the area, you ought to come down. It's going to be really good. Really want to thank our sponsor, Chrysler, for making this possible. Want to thank all the different brands at Chrysler LLC for having joined in on the party, too. So, folks, Jim and I are going to continue cruising here. But for right now, John McElroy signing off for this Woodward Live show coming to you thanks to Chrysler.
Autoline Live from Woodward Avenue is brought to you by our signature sponsor, Chrysler, imported from Detroit.